Albums, the cornerstone of modern musical entertainment. In some ways, we consider them audible films. In recent years, I've been fascinated with the album process. I've listened to countless records, different sizes and tones, yet I never knew how they were made. I narrowed it down to three aspects when I was younger. People write the song, someone sings the song, and the band provides the music. And while these are essential elements and the ones most people gawk at, production, in my opinion, is the most important. While lyricists, vocalists, and musicians create the grand vision of the album, it's the job of the producer to take all of these grand ideas together and forge it into something far greater than the sum of its parts. There are many admirable producers at work today in country music, each bringing their own signature style to the genre, for better or for worse. I kind of view producers as directors at times, and to me, the producer who sits at the throne of Nashville and country music at large is Dave Cobb. You've probably read his name a few times or so. He has his signature style to record albums in non-studio settings and use technology and techniques that aren't modern in order to capture a fuller and warmer sound. Traits that have begun to be used by so many other stars in both mainstream and indie. The man has become a modern legend in country music. He's responsible for so many masterpieces and marvelous records that it's mind-blowing, to a point where it's safe to say that he has the best batting average out of any producer currently working in country music. The way he manages to put out quality albums with any substantial dives being rare is incredible. So today, I'm dedicating an entire video to the albums he's worked on in the past 10 years. Only rules are the album must be on the official Dave Cobb website. So with all that said, let's dive right in.
Oh, it's disgusting!
Let's just get this over with. These albums are possibly the worst experience I've ever had with any music. After years and years of trying to avoid these dumpster fires, I was forced to check them out because Dave Cobb's name was on them, and yeah, they're horrible. I know I was just hyping up Dave Cobb as this grand visionary, and even I was shocked he was a part of this. What I can assume is that Wheeler Walker Jr., or whatever his real name is, broke into Dave Cobb's house, put a motherfucking gun to his head, and forced him to produce this album among the other captive musicians. At least that's my headcanon. I genuinely am shocked at how low of a bar this album is. Let's get the elephant in the room out of the way. The humor. The same joke done over and over. It's not like I was really offended much as I expected this in the beginning. It's just that the jokes are so pathetic and cringe that it isn't even worth getting angry over. Genuine anger towards this worthless junk probably would have boosted it to a 1 because I actually got something out of it. But no, I was emotionless throughout the entire album. And it's not like I don't have a funny bone. I've seen some really good comedic albums and songs throughout the years. And believe me, this was not it. It's just haha funny dick joke. Haha, I said the F word. The albums wanted to get a reaction out of me so bad, but it didn't put in the effort because the writing of this album came from an idiot. This garbage is worse than SNL comedy. No, that doesn't say enough. It's worse than Amy Schumer comedy. I wish I could praise the music itself, which is country-esque, but for the most part, it's monotonous and outright soulless. Plus, they're the only Dave Cobb projects I'd genuinely call compressed, where the sound felt unbalanced and using compression is such a horrible solution to the problem. Maybe it was the only Dave Cobb project that didn't use a signature style. I don't know. All I do know is now that I've talked about this garbage barge of releases, I have no reason to ever talk about them again. I'm gonna listen to Graffiti U as a palate cleanser. That's how bad it was.
Stop singing!
2015, I consider not only one of the best years for country music, but music at large. So many masterpieces and great albums came throughout this era. But man, did this album bore me to tears. I don't know much about Cobb. Apparently he's the Canadian country king and a lot of people love him. I didn't really know he existed till I listened to this album and he appeared on that trash Kojo song. And this album doesn't really paint this guy in a positive light for me. The biggest thing I can get out of the album is that, and I really hate to say this, but Cobb can't sing. Normally, weak vocals aren't that much of an issue, but his vocal performance is such a major detriment, turning every song into a slight annoyance at best to insufferable at worst. Lyrically, I also found this one pretty dry, honestly. Some songs have neat concepts like Sunbeam and S Lazy H. However, these songs play out like vignettes that keep coming with no rhyme or reason. The album's sonic palette is interesting, I'll give it that. Solder City has a unique tone, but the aesthetic is pretty dull on it and the issue spreads throughout the album. It's the only album where I think Dave Cobb should not have been the producer. He's doing a great job as always, but with Cobb's style of country and the way he sings, it doesn't really come out particularly good. Although, I will say Goodbye Colorado is an exception. I don't know what happened or really care, but this song is great. And Lund pulls off a surprisingly enjoyable performance in what is for the most part an incredibly average record. People may love this guy a lot, but I just couldn't get into this album. The only note I had for Southernality was an actually good version of Kid Rock. And honestly, yeah, that sounds about right. I'd say this aligns more with Southern Rock of the 70s and early 80s. All the songs are bangers, and that's about it. If you want an album to simply just vibe to with no ambitious storytelling and any deep themes but constantly provides a good time, this album's probably for you. However, as someone who likes to feel Western music, I can't really say this album provided much for me personally. There's a few songs I can connect with, like Sunday Morning, but for the most part, I just feel these are gritty fluff. I'd enjoy to hear all this stuff on country radio. If they had the label power, I'm confident every single song would succeed on radio. They're just that catchy. But catchy music only goes so far for me. Writing is a tad bit too repetitive for my liking, and there's not a lot of musical variety, truth be told. It's kinda hard to distinguish a fair amount of this record, but for what I got, I enjoyed myself a little bit. Whiskey Myers is such a weird phenomenon. They get better with each album. I didn't really like Firewater that much, and their latest self-titled project is great. So their third studio album, Early Morning Shakes, feels like the midpoint between their first and their latest. I like some songs, namely the opening track. It's a great tone setter for what the album has to behold. There are some really exceptional stories to be told on here, like Dogwood, which blurs the lines between the aggressive rock and soothing country-esque sounds. But this album has to be in a constant state of grace, and when it's not, it sort of falls apart. And that happens too much for my personal liking. Headstone particularly sees them drowning in their influences of far greater rock bands. Reckoning doesn't really impress me melodically, and some of the stories, truth be told, I just found were kind of pointless. I'm not the biggest fan of the format, but truth be told, you could reduce this to an 8 or 9 track album, and you essentially wouldn't miss much. This isn't an intrusive album like Ko Wetso, but the really good stuff this album has diminishes pretty quickly, and when it does, it feels pretty obvious in my opinion. On the bright side, with each mistake each album makes, they fix most of, if not all, the issues on the next album.
My roommate was a frog kid. You ever see a frog kid?
Mud definitely seems to be the fan favorite of all the Whiskey Myers albums, but I gotta admit, this album is a tad bit overrated. I feel like its portrayals of Southern culture aren't as profound as many claim to be, and a lot of the themes and messages presented are just face value. Even some of the musical ideas presented I just found were Like, On the River's abrupt tempo changes doesn't feel properly executed and just random, if I'm being honest. Lightning Bugs and Rain, while a great song individually, doesn't really jive with the rest of the album, and you can tell a lot of the time they just bit far more than they could chew, which doesn't allow them to execute their songs as well as they could. Deep Down in the South goes so hard in the rock side, and while the story the song tells matches the grit pretty well, I couldn't really find an emotional connection with the far grander theme of the album. Southern Pride songs have never been my thing, so it's probably just a me thing. A fair amount of the ambitiousness doesn't really pay off in my opinion, but dear god, the moments that do hit, really do hit. Stone is one of the best songs on any of the albums on this list. The message of the music life is one I absolutely adore, and here it's so passionately delivered. The album has flickers of greatness in what is, truth be told, a bit of a mess, and I think what shocks me is that I'm the only one that feels this way. Whiskey Myers Mud is considered to be up there with all the great country band records of the past few years. I'm glad people can emote with the grit in the story this album presents, but to me, it's just okay.
Get to the bridge if you wanna live!
What about Prancer?
Prancer belongs in the canyon now!
For the life of me, I did not know if Brent Cobb and Dave Cobb were related. I just thought that was a coincidence, but no, turns out they're cousins. Anyway, Providence Canyon is pretty good. I think it's a bit weaker than its predecessor, but there's still plenty to enjoy. Like Lorraine. Good god, this song is a tearjerker. All about letting someone go so they can pursue their dreams and passions, saying it'll be alright and they'll meet again, even though chances are, they will never see each other again. Or When the Dust Settles, all about putting your heart and soul into your craft, and if you don't, is that dream really worth it? With these scenes concluding with Ain't a Road Too Long, where we get to see this character's motivations for going the way he does, and how to them, it's all worth it at the end of the day. The final portion of this album is some of the best music modern country can offer. The rest of it is just okay. Yeah, to me, this album peaks incredibly hard in the final 5 tracks with some of the most exceptional moments in Brent Cobb's career, but I gotta admit, this album takes forever to get going in my opinion, to a point where one could argue it doesn't really properly start. The first few songs just feel like hollow homages to past greats, especially Lynyrd Skynyrd, and truth be told, I don't think that's where Brent thrives at all. His way of emotional storytelling is what I find exceptional, and I feel like 2/3 of this record is kinda wasted potential, wasted on these semi-decent to pretty solid rock jams. Because there's a masterpiece in this record, and I'm a little bitter that it wasn't as fully realized as it could be.
I don't-
don't like them putting chemicals in the water that turn the friggin' frogs gay.
On Shooter's half self-titled album, there's this line.
To Willie, from Lubbock to Green Hall, from Bonnie Bone to Alex Jones.
Apart from that stupid line, I really like this album. This is the type of music I wish Texas country would be doing these days. It may still be rooted in traditionalism, but there's this ambitiousness I absolutely love. Bound to Get Down, while on the weaker side lyrically, is just an absolute blast. There's some influence from his father Waylon Jennings, but for the most part, Shooter comes off as his own individual. There's a clear-cut production that despite being 24 on this list due to some lack of profoundness and even some dry-placed vocals, this is actually one of the best produced projects on this list. And I really feel like this comes down to Shooter and Dave's friendship, and given their work with Brandi Carlile's latest album, these two can accomplish magic together. This album isn't perfect. Drunk While Soulful is a pretty generic drinking song in hindsight. I'm Wild and My Woman Is Crazy is probably my least favorite song. I feel like while yes, this album could have cut some songs, I frankly wanted more out of this record. More songs, please, because this album just offers so much potential and it didn't reach the peak in my opinion. And this is one of the rare moments where I think more music could have accomplished that. But apart from the duds previously mentioned, I love the way Shooter and Cobb envision a majority of the songs. It's all exceptionally produced. And after how good this album turned out overall, I'm intrigued to see what Shooter has next, because if they finally tune some of the misses this album had, you have a masterpiece on your hands with their next record together.
Kid, lay off the details. I haven't even had my cup of apple blood yet.
You mean apple juice?
No.
The very first Dave Cobb record of the 2010s takes on the classic sounds of artists like Tammy Wynette, given a rich, glossy, modern vision with Dave Cobb. This album is definitely down there on the songwriting spectrum, but its hooks and instrumentals are what really sold me on this album. Some might not be into this album as much as I am, as it could be too much of a wholesome experience, and overwhelming positivity isn't for everyone, but this album just leaves a grin on my face. All About You and My Heart Skips a Beat are just so irresistible, the classical musical styles are just presented so well. Maybe it's nostalgia bias that it landed as high as it did. If I had any real complaint, is that there isn't much of a dynamic as other duos. Truth be told, I can't really distinguish either of them, and what I personally look for is that chemistry that makes a duo distinguishable. But with these two sounding almost alike, to the point where I could have easily mistaken it for voiceover harmonies, it sort of left a pale taste in my mouth in that regard. However, this is such an unhateable record, I kinda can't ignore it. An impeccable blast from the past from a duo I'm keen to deep dive into their discography later in the future. If you love the classic tone of country and want that modern flair and aesthetic, this album is definitely for you.
You're old.
If you told me Dave Cobb produced with a 90 star 5 years ago, I probably wouldn't have believed you. But this album sees Cobb putting his own twist on the 90s country sound on Travis Tritt's Set in Stone. I have my problems like with any 90s revival album. Some of the messages aren't that profound. Smoking a Bottle is basically Travis complaining about being a boomer surrounded by Gen Z. I'm not even joking. The middle portion begins to lose sight of what the album is really about. The sonic palette does kind of get repetitive after a while as well, to a point where a song or two definitely could have been cut, but there's just something about this album I find pretty captivating. In a way, this is a character study of a man way outside his prime trying to fit in with modern society, and he simply can't. I find the journey this album takes super compelling, and the way it presents this theme is just really interesting. I don't necessarily agree with Travis, but I don't think I'm supposed to. There's just a lot of nuanced pain presented. He sees himself as a has-been legend, and watching the world go by and a bit disappointed by it. And I think Better Off Dead is the emotional resolve of the album. I wish the album paid more time to the themes of mortality and regret, but even when it isn't, the album just thoroughly entertains me. Except for Way Down in Georgia, that song is doo-doo. Stand Your Ground is a certified banger, the rocking guitars and pumping energy is just so much better than how I'm describing it. Southern Man, while not profound in any way, brings in a gothic flair I always love to see. Set in Stone has more flaws than the average record, but Travis managed to pull off a really exceptional album. One of the best mainstream country records of the past year, in my opinion.
That's called boy tipping!
I might get a little hate for leaving this out of the top 20. I just want to clarify. I think this album is really good, and it comes from one of my favorite storytellers. But with that said, number 21 is Song of the Plains by Colter Wall. Similar to how Whiskey Myers gets better with every release, I feel the opposite with Colter Wall. He gets ever so slightly worse with everything he does, except Western Swings and Waltzes, that broke the cycle. While I adore the storytelling as usual, I feel like this one just didn't express as much personality as his self-titled or imaginary Appalachia. dare I say, it was kinda boring. I feel like this really comes down to the lack of ensemble. I'm all for a man pouring his heart out into a six string, and while the stories Coulter gives us are phenomenal as usual, there's something about the backgrounds on the songs like Sleeping on the Blacktop and Kate McKinnon that really increased the grandeur of it all, and having a bunch of solo acoustic songs with very little, if not zero, accompaniment gets a little stale after a while. Coulter does great as usual, Saskatchewan in 1881 is fantastic, Wild Bill Hickok is incredibly satisfying, Coulter has not lost his lyrical touch whatsoever on this record, but strong writing isn't enough without proper presentation, which this album struggles to maintain. Thinking on a Woman is one of the few songs with a proper accompaniment, but it's one of my least favorite songs, which doesn't feel like a coincidence. Out of all the Coulter Wall projects, it feels like it's trying the least, if I'm honest, even though the minimal effort still produces something amazing regardless. I know Coulter's voice is a modern marvel, but given how much was done on his past two releases, Songs of the Plains, Truth Be Told feels like the short end of the stick.
Long story short, this is my grave. Want me to make you one too?
It's probably a hot take when I say Shine on Rainy Day is superior to Providence Canyon, and yes, I said that right, that's the name of the album. Sure, this album doesn't have a Lorraine or Truth Be Told anything really powerful to say, but out of all the albums that doesn't really tell ambitious stories or relay us with deep messages, this album works as a simple slice of life country record. Its sense of home and the longing to reach is displayed really well. I especially love the detail of, there's a town in South Georgia so humble and small, if you sneeze driving through it, you won't see it all. Brent Cobb, not Dave Cobb, has this way of making music that feels intentionally designated for the road. There's always a sense of warmth, adventure, really just longing to spectate while driving that I really admire in his records. Songs designed to be listened to at high speed on the highway, some 20-mile drives in the country, and even some for traffic with Down in the Gully. Sure, the album isn't as clean as others, the high range of Brett isn't really that impressive on this record, and some of the mixing does feel a little intrusive. All I really have left to say is, it's a vibe. One of the ones I just had a lot of fun with, which is fine. Sometimes I don't need to cry or think, gosh, that makes me look at the world different. And for a guy who rolls his eye that a lot of the radio slot people are fed on the daily, I'm glad I can go to this album for specifically that. I may not connect with a lot of what he's saying, as a lot of it isn't really that interesting to begin with, but this album takes its simple themes and presents them in a way that screams classic and raw, which is what a lot of country offered in the first place. Gucci bag, stacks on stacks, diamonds fill up the champagne glass. Dave Cobb producing a Zac Brown Band album is an insane fact of life, but not as insane as Nico Moon co-writing one of the very best Zac Brown Band songs. No, I am not joking. This is probably the most contemporary Cobb has ever gotten country-wise. I know this album gets a bit of hate and disdain and is usually near the bottom of the Zac Brown Band tier list for a lot of people.
Yeah, from me.
No, you're not in this episode.
Anyways, Welcome Home, to me, nails a lot of what made this group so great. Keyword made, as in past tense, as they suck now. People love the beachy tone of the group, but on the inverse, I love the autumn tones the group can throw down, and they do that insanely well. Your Majesty and My Old Man accomplish that to a T. Like any post-Uncaged album, with every win you get with an album or song, there's concessions to be made. There's not nearly as much experimentation, the multi-harmonies are pretty much non-existent, and it feels a little bit at a time where they operate more as an ensemble rather than a band. The instrumental magic fails to come out when this album needs it the most, like in Roots especially, despite it being a banger. But despite these concessions, you get a lot in return. This is easily the grandest Zac Brown Band album. Yeah, I said it. It just has the largest scope, and I feel like all that credit should go to Cobb. And this is easily the best vocal performance Zac Brown has ever given. The passion this man displays is even greater than the best Zac Brown Band albums. My Old Man is one of the best songs of its year, let alone Zac Brown Band. I still can't believe Nico Moon wrote this. This man wrote this masterpiece. Makes you think if the dude is wasting his talents. I think it's a little evident that Cobb was in new waters producing for the group, as some moments, especially the musical climaxes, are overproduced, which is a rare thing to see from Cobb, but despite that, it was nice to see the Zac Brown Band one last time before all hell broke loose. Man, I have an overwhelming tendency to drop a fan favorite in the number 18 spot on my list. I put Platinum at number 18 on my Grammy album ranking, Where Were You When the World Stopped Turning on my Grammy song ranking, and here, I put John Prine's The Tree of Forgiveness. This album has gone down as a bit of a classic for the alt-country and Americana scene. This album was his final ever before his passing in 2020. There's a sense of acceptance in death, and John Prine's gravelly voice has a way of sinking into this sense of time and age many songs aren't able to accomplish. We've seen many songs from guys singing about the end of life, but here, more than any other album, it truly feels like we're witnessing it, making all the words Prine say feel all the more profound. There's a sense of sadness and outright joy joy that I love to see. I do feel like some songs could have been due with another take, like Ordinary Blue, and it kinda has similar issues that Song of the Plains did with the lack of ensemble. I get big budget ensemble accompaniment isn't good with Prine at this point of his life, but I do think muted accompaniment wasn't a proper solution for some of these tracks either. Besides that, despite his age, Prine still has a sense of humor and relatability I adore. His view of face being like a washing machine bouncing around till his sins are washed clean just hit me immensely hard. The album is neat in a way, as while it starts out sad in the first half and gets more optimistic, I found myself crying far more in the back half rather than the first. If you adore the human experience, I can't recommend this album enough. One of the best farewells country has seen since Johnny Cash's American 4.
I put my hands on your body, it feels like, hey, it's a fucking scarecrow again.
Normally, I'd rank these albums separate, but the From a Room recordings don't really have much of an underlying message behind either of them, and I'm relatively equal on both. They're really good, I mean, what did you expect? It's Chris Stapleton. I may have lost Casey into making cheap pop music, but I have faith Stapleton will be the first to pass the 5-album test. What both of the From a Room recordings have in common is that they have a lot of great stuff, along with songs I generally don't care for. I mean, the songs essentially were just demo songs finally being recorded, no songs play off each other, they're really just individual vignettes. Broken Halos is an exceptional folk song, and I love how it makes itself clear as the polar opposite of Traveler, tone and aesthetic-wise. Second One to Know is a banger, which shows off those belting vocals. There's even a sense of classic influence with Up to No Good Living. However, on Volume 1, there is some moments where you kinda honestly forget this is a Chris Stapleton record. Even on the more somber songs, adding more emotion in both the delivery and the instrumentals felt kinda shocking given who it's from. Death Row and Without Your Love, while excellent conceptually, don't really have the most effective presentation. I would have appreciated Chris showing a bit more exaggeration compared to some of the other tracks that are out there. On Volume 2, this album, while having the lowest lows of both records, I did end up favoring this record by a little bit. Millionaire is something I've never liked. I've always found it a bit too plucky and corny for my liking. But your cuts like Scarecrow in the Garden and Midnight Train to Memphis liven this side of these two projects very nicely. Nobody Lonely Tonight probably strikes the perfect balance between the aesthetic and vocal dominance Chris showed on the past and future records. The pieces were here for a masterpiece on the level of Traveler, and unlike his contemporaries who rarely do it, Chris actually did use the highs of this as a foundation for his next project, which we will get to very soon. After the disappointment of the Canadian Cor Blund, I wish there was a great album that was from Canada that released in 2015. Oh wait! Faded Gloryville is so much of what I adore about Canadian country compared to its American counterpart. Similar to Providence Canyon, I found myself really enjoying the record in the latter half, but unlike Providence Canyon, Lindy Ortega kept me entertained throughout its entirety. Ashes, the opening track, sees her mixing up the genres of rock and soul with this beautiful melancholy ballad about the aftermath of romance. The self-titled track, while not really long lyrically, wastes absolutely no time enveloping you in this bleakness without even giving you real details of this place. Just what it does to people, which I find all the more compelling. Rundown Neighborhood is when the album really began to knock it out of the park for me. With this grand and powerful message of questioning ourselves, our relationships, after a sizable amount of time has passed, whether what we are doing right now is right or wrong, and like the best songs do, it doesn't answer that for us. Rather, we decide what the answer is ourselves. In some ways, I think this album handles the themes of Same Trailer, Different Park far greater than that album ever did, acknowledging a sense of brokenness of where we currently are, but unlike that album, establishes connections and places in a way that far outshines it. With deeper looks into relationship struggles with I Ain't the Girl and Someday Soon, a sense of person versus society with Faded Gloryville and Rundown Neighborhood, I think my only issue with this album is the reverb feels a tad bit overused and takes me out of the music from time to time. Since Casey has decided to pursue new avenues and themes, I'm glad I can count on someone like Lindy Ortega for compelling messages like this. Okay, we're about to hit the top 15s, 8 out of 10s and above. I mean, I gave Lindy an 8 out of 10, but top 16 doesn't sound as fun, and there's an odd number of albums, but I digress. This list only gets tougher and tougher from here on out.
Look at me, I'm unforgivable. Well, here's the unforeseeable. I forgive you. After all you've done.
By the way, I Forgive You managed to be a profound look on society while maintaining a sense of poeticness and charm all the way through, which in this day and age of pop culture, it's kinda hard to do, let's be honest. I know everyone was gawking at Kacey Musgraves in 2018, but Brandi Carlile deserves just as much love. As this album, while not as cohesive as their previous or follow-up, this album's clear goal almost immediately is to shed a light on those who struggle and are really cast down by society. For a lesser album, this probably would collapse in on itself, but this is not a lesser album. It takes its time to create multiple layers with its stories in a similar fashion to Brandi Clark's 12 stories. Most of the tales don't really connect literally, but all share the same message: give empathy to those who struggle with raising a child and the mother. It kind of makes me wonder how much of an annoyance I was as a kid. Sugartooth provides a different perspective of addiction, saying it always isn't the person's fault, even though most of the time that's who society chooses to blame. I kind of want to just leave it at that, as I don't want to spoil anything else this song offers, as I think it should be experienced blindly. I will say, I don't get the hype over the titular song, The Joke. I mean, I still really enjoy the song. It's a very empowering track, but like, it's not as flexing as hard as some of the other songs like Party of One or Sugartooth for that matter. But if I had to name a favorite track, it would probably be Most of All, which shows the underlying themes of death of a parent. It's presented in two ways. We either see our parents as good all of a sudden, as whatever trauma we had ceases towards guilt, or quite possibly we see what they did for us in a new perspective. This song hit me immensely hard, and it's become one of my favorite songs from here. It's certainly not perfect. Some of the themes that are directly focused on romance I feel fall flat personally, but this album is extremely consistent and stays on course for a majority of its runtime.
Corpse, you doing that card swipe?
Huh? Yes, I've failed it 15 times so far. What about it?
After the success of Imaginary Appalachia, Coulter Wall took a step back and decided to take on a more laid-back approach, ditching the more gothic tone of his previous record. His self-titled album is more western and folk-like, and while some of the solo acoustic tracks on Songs of the Plants could come off iffy, most of the songs here are fine the way they are, with how Coulter delivers the tale he weaves, increasing the ambiance of the songs, especially dark ones like Kate McKinnon. It may seem grim at first glance, but there's some heartwarming moments like Me and Big Dave. The album has its fair share of fictional stories, but I'd say the album shines the most with stories that ring true, like Transcendental Rambling Railroad Blues. It's in a way his own Mr. Misunderstood, seemingly highlighting his life, or an exaggerated version of it at least, as well as the aforementioned Me and Big Dave. I can't praise his and Tyler Childers' rendition of Fraulein enough. These two couldn't be more distinguishable, yet blend together so perfectly. I think most will think the production here is a tad bit lazy or different from Cobb's previous work with the likes of Sturgill and Stapleton, but truth be told, this album sees Cobb once more in new territories, and for what came out is rock solid. I don't get some of the mixing choices, like I hear the same instrument, but it's softer in one ear. I checked with two speakers individually to check if it was just me, but I was correct. Some of the mixing on the record is just a bit scrambled. Apart from that, Cobb continues to sharpen his skills and prove his versatility with all these artists he works with, most having nothing in common, which really is a testament to Cobb as a producer.
Has the whole world gone crazy? Am I the only one around here who gives a shit about the rules?
Ian No is really an underrated gem in the underground world of country. Yet despite that looking iffy on paper, he manages to make his own signature when borrowing the styles of others. This album more than any feels like a blast from the past, homing in the classic sounds of the 60s and 70s, even down to the lyrical styles. The album opens up with The Bright Irene. The album, while being positive for the most part, there's a sense of darkness throughout the entire album, which to me manifests in Between the Country, which is also the final song on the album. I think Ian presents a way of storytelling that rivals his contemporaries in the Appalachian field, to a point where I'd even argue he's the strongest at the moment. The album is tightly written, none of the songs feel like a weak link, all play off each other greatly, even if there's no underlying connectivity. It's finely tuned production-wise more than any other Cobb record to date. While the production does home into a more classic period, it doesn't feel dated. It just feels like the songs of the past are given a taste of the present. Ian No on his debut album knocked it out of the park, and I can only hope we see more of him in the future. Sturgill's debut album is great. Now that the Pantology is complete, I feel like I appreciate this album way more, as it represents a story of first life before ascension. This album really juggles a lot of things all at once, showing a vast emotional array keeping up with the narrative of life, while also reviving the outlaw sound in a big way. The album does all of this in a surprisingly short runtime, and whatever flaws existed on this record would be evened out on his next project, but the highs of this record are just as high as any of the five main Sturgill records. Life Ain't Fair and The World Is Mean is both a middle finger and harsh truths all at the same time on the state of the industry. You Can Have the Crown is arguably Sturgill's best jam, and I feel like some of the songwriting here doesn't get the appreciation it deserves. I love the verses of Railroad of Sin. Old King Cole takes his place among all the tragic coal mining songs we've seen throughout the years. Really emotional stuff. The album isn't focused on one particular story, but it captures the human experience, at least that of a musician, that's really captivating. A bit of it centers around the stories of musicians trying to make their way in the world, with an ending stronger than any of his albums. Cobb's experience with Sturgill would begin a long and very successful path for the both of them, which would begin the return to a lot of what made country so special during its dark age in the 2010s. If you want to credit an album for the latest neo-traditional renaissance, it's not Luke Combs, Midland, John Party, or Chris Stapleton, it's Sturgill and this excellent album. After nearly half a decade of hiatus without a proper follow-up, Chris Stapleton finally delivered. Starting Over is quite everything you'd want out of a follow-up and more. It takes some of the aspects from Traveler and the From a Room recordings, combining them into something truly exceptional. The album settles you in with one of the most heartwarming openings to any country album the past few years, getting you into the story of escapism and longing. We get a look into Chris himself with Joy of My Life and When I'm With You, Maggie's song. All of these songs are the emotional core of the album. And this album isn't exclusive to ballads. Arkansas and Whiskey Sunrise, Chris gives his best performance since Traveler, and I can see people arguing that Starting Over surpasses Traveler in that aspect. The band is stronger than ever. A lot of these guitar riffs are more prevalent, have way more impact than Traveler. I think the album has not a single bad track, but it does have songs that don't really jive with the rest of the album, like Watch You Burn, which doesn't add anything truly special in the grand scheme of the record. But man, does this album take a majority of the pieces presented and knock them all back down again with Nashville, Tennessee. Talk about a powerful closer. In a way, it makes me wonder if we'll see another Stapleton record. This album presents a compelling look at a man who's tired and wants to rest, and if this is the final Stapleton record, well then, it's a perfect way to go out then. Starting Over is one of the rare albums that are thoroughly entertaining and doesn't overstay its welcome. It deserves every ounce of critical acclaim. Chances are, it's your future Grammy-winning country album, and it's so much better than Dangerous. Stop lying to yourself. It is. Okay, we're about to enter the top 10, the 9 out of 10s and above. This list was extremely difficult to get through at this point, as so many of them are iconic and special in their own way. But let's get on with it.
I'm a special kind of white guy.
Okay, so if this album offends you because it panders to the SJWs, grow the fuck up. The moments where that occurs have actual structural problems after you drop your fragile egos. The Nashville sound to this day remains a polarizing release because of its minor political influences, most of which aren't presented that well admittedly. White Man's World is kind of mediocre, not gonna lie. Apart from the message itself actually being compelling, this song just kind of falls over itself with a lot of redundancy musically. Not to mention with political songs, it's best not to be vague and quite direct in my opinion, which this song doesn't accomplish honestly, but that's really all I got. This one mediocre song is really the only flaw in what is without a doubt a masterpiece. Like many of the Isbell albums, they're really a character study, taking on complexities with no easy answers, or answers to begin with. If We Were Vampires is one of the grandest love story songs ever written, up there with some of the best, honestly. Last of My Kind is your millennial complains about Gen Z song, but what sets it apart from the others is the pain and confusion Isbell exhibits, to a point where I'd say this song, and really the album itself, is about fears, specifically surrounded by abandonment. I mean, there's literally a song called Anxiety. Albums like Southeastern were about conquering inner demons, and this album feels like it's continuing those themes with the fear of them returning. This album explores so many themes of escapism, mortality, even racism, with the album ending with Isbell seeing hope for the future. After all the grim and even intense moments this album offered, it's just really great to see a positive way to close out the story compared to the bittersweet endings of Southeastern and Something More Than Free. These three albums really feel like a trilogy of Isbell the past few years, and the Nashville sound closes out this trilogy of his life in such a powerful and unforgettable way. I almost forgot to go over the richness this album has in its alt-rock influences. It's really nice to see the genres intersect in such an interesting way, especially during a time in country where experimentation was being encouraged. Ignore all the people who want to shout this album down, because it's easily one of the most exemplary albums Isbell's ever made. Once more, the people that most likely crap on this are people who didn't listen to the album and they think they're better than it. The Highwayman self-titled is already bold based on the title alone. And I too was a bit nervous based on the title. I was worried it was gonna be similar to The Man, and we all know how much that song sucked. But nah man, this album is truly incredible. I've heard all the complaints, the mixing's off, the unison singing doesn't go that well together, all of which are valid criticisms. You know, I was thinking about that. And the thing is, I really don't care. All of those things, while I can see being an issue for some, weren't really a problem for me, because the music is just that excellent. The vocal blend did take a while to grow on me, but they've become quite enjoyable. And I feel like this album takes a lot of influences from Ian Noh's album in terms of its great aesthetics and propping up these classic sounds and musical styles in a way that feels modern and innovative. The opening song does something so bold by taking the melodic and rhythmical structures of the original Highwaymen song, yet reworked the story and message entirely to a point where it's even greater than the original song. Screw that. The album itself is better than the three Highwaymen records, and to all the people mad at that statement, I'm sure most of them have only heard the titular song. This album, while having its political influences here and there, presents them in a way that far outclasses the Nashville sound with the opening track Crowded Table. The album is so carefully crafted with its themes of parental responsibilities and My Name Can't Be Mama, as well as having the inverse with Old Soul. If you seriously think all this album is woke feminist stuff, you don't even know what those words mean. Because the stories are all heartfelt, tragic,
joyous, outright petty, and inspiring. After the misstep that was Maren Morris's Girl, this album really feels like the next step in getting powerful stories from women across in a mainstream setting. I'll probably dedicate a video to this because it has so much divisiveness and deserves nothing but outright praise.
Let it die, let it die, let it shrivel up and come on, who's with me, huh?
You know, if I had a nickel for every time an album had the word The Tree on the title and was produced by Dave Cobb, I'd have two nickels. Which isn't a lot, but it's weird that it happened twice, right? I think it's safe to say that Lori McKenna has the best batting average of any country artist, indie or mainstream. She has consistently put out some of the most intellectual music of anybody, not just country. It's to a point where I consider her the Wes Anderson of country music. She developed such a unique and unforgettable style which, while itself doesn't really grow, it's capable of fitting the molds of so many different stories and themes. To me, The Tree is about growth. It's not a concept record, but it does fixate on the idea of growing into people, often something more. The Fixer sees a person who does his best to fix the problems he finds in the world and with people, and despite this person's ambition, they have to accept that there's some things beyond their help, in a way that's presented as a cold truth that's a bit tough to swallow. It's one of the most profound messages I've experienced in my entire life, and Lori McKenna goes the extra mile in making it all more poetic and real. Lori controls vividness and imagery near flawlessly, using objects we use in our everyday lives and don't expect to see in a song, yet they make the songs all the more profound. People Get Old is probably the best song out of any of these albums on this entire list. Imagine putting an existential crisis in a song. This song broke me, as it has done to so many people. The passing of time and the progression of realizing we're becoming our parents, whether we realize that's good or bad. Growing up is scary to a lot of people, and it's scary for me. This album really made it a lot easier for me. Its perspectives of young love and its eventual collapse is just sad, yet beautiful, yet also tragic. The album acknowledges time in a way so little albums are capable of doing, if only for a few fleeting moments. Is this album perfect? Certainly not. I personally don't think it wraps up its ending as well as other albums, and sonically, this album can feel redundant at times, but the highs are so dang high, those feelings feel minuscule for how grand and well-realized this album is.
Sir, do you know why I pulled you over? Yeah, because your town is broke as f***.
Following up what many consider to be your masterpiece is always an uphill climb. The amount of pressure is inconsequential. The expectations of expansion and follow-up made everything Something More Than Free had going for it stacked against it. Yet despite all of that, Jason Isbell managed to deliver another masterpiece. It's not quite as good as Southeastern, but it manages to maintain all the hallmarks for Isbell Records. The alt-rock and country blending, the impeccable lyrics, which I'd argue is superior to Southeastern, albeit barely. This album lacks the passion and significance of Southeastern, but it makes up for that with how high everything is. Some of my favorite Isbell songs came from this album. Flagship is a masterpiece of emotional storytelling depicting an aging romance, and despite fearing the worst, he highlights all these things that make it work through the comparison to an old hotel. The way Isbell uses comparisons to seemingly minuscule objects and locations to emote these complex themes is one of the reasons Something More Than Free stands as tall as well as it does. The album explores themes of guilt and introspection, maybe not directly about Isbell because last time I checked he still has three fingers. Some of the stories here are incredibly hard to swallow and will turn the most innocent minded away from this record, but songs like Speed Trap Town handle the subject material they're tackling with care. The album depicts Southern culture in a way that's so difficult to shy away from, as Isbell makes everything so enticing with its imagery. And for albums and songs that depict Southern cultures as nothing but cringe, it's absolutely stunning to see a raw, genuine and phenomenal record show beautiful yet also harsh lights on the South.
Vagabondia Chronicles!
The final six are what many consider the magnum opus of six incredible people. These legit are some of my favorite albums of all time, and they are responsible for me loving country, no, just music itself as much as I do. If ranking the Nashville Sound at 10 wasn't a sign of this ranking heating up, my number six pick is Traveler, aka the best record to win the Grammy Award for Best Country Album, often considered the magnum opus of this decade of Nashville. It's not like I really disagree with those statements because Traveler is a spectacle to behold, with the majority of the credit going to Chris Stapleton's voice. His vocal performance on this album is unparalleled by anyone in this list. Hell, maybe any artist who released in the past 10 years. The belting and impact Chris leaves is a make or break for some people, but for someone who loves balance and texture in someone's voice, Chris absolutely nails that on this record. The album story really isn't the clearest, but I'd compare it to the story of modern-day Drifter, only far more emotional and fleshed out. It feels above all else the story of a journey with no end, someone longing for adventure. The opening brings us into this lush and rich setting pretty much perfectly. Chris, or the person he portrays on this record, is a confused and emotionally scarred individual, trying to find himself, nailing all of the emotional beats near flawlessly with Fire Away and Whiskey and You, while also providing some great down-to-earth moments with When the Stars Come Out. And this is when we see the deeper sides to Chris that aren't all rugged and bombastic. The album is above all else an outlaw record and remains that way throughout the entire runtime, which is excellent. But I love when Stapleton shows something deeper, even if it isn't his peak. It's tightly written, an absolute emotional rollercoaster of a record, and vocally one of the best experiences I've ever witnessed on an album. I'm glad Stapleton has risen to a household name because he deserves it. It may not be a revolutionary album like Metamodern Sounds was, but it made all the future quality releases possible.
But this one says, I'm an otter! With a dark side.
Now this is a double album. The guitar song is a masterpiece and a massive step up from That Lonesome Song in nearly every way. It probably accomplished the most impressive feat with having 25 fantastic songs never really taking me out of the experience. I briefly touched upon this album's uniqueness in my double album video. The first half of this record focuses on the darkness that lingers. Even if the music itself is relatively positive, the messages are nowhere near that. The album's atmosphere is probably my favorite out of any on this list. The album takes tried and true tropes of the star life, breakups, and approaches them in tones and perspectives that are all unique and equally refreshing. With Cover Your Eyes and Mental Revenge accomplishing this to a T. Cover Your Eyes using that specific act to cover up the pain of this person leaving their partner. The buildup and passion displayed is excellent. I don't think I've ever been disturbed by a petty song. I've almost always had a good time or a fun laugh. But with Mental Revenge, it honestly feels sick and just terrifying, but in a good way. I love the contrast between the black and the white album with Johnson's delivery. It almost feels like a split personality at times. It's just that distinct. The White Album, while not quite as perfect, still manages to be super compelling. Unlike most double albums, you cannot just cut one album out, because you're cutting out half of one of the most meticulously crafted albums ever made. Whereas the Black Album delved into dark outlaw, the White Album takes on a more neo-traditional approach, along with even some uplifting gospel. Good Morning Sunrise is the most uplifting Jamie Johnson has ever been, and given how dark he can get on his projects, it's so nice to see. The album starts out dark and desolate, and goes on to become an uplifting experience, and the fact almost everything changes stylistically as it goes along is one of the most ingenious moments I've ever seen an album do. If you're one of those who believe more equals better, I can't recommend this album enough. Southeastern is nothing less than a stunning achievement on every level. Arguably the most iconic low-profile album to date in terms of Cobb's repertoire, this album stands as one of the most profound tales of abuse and addiction ever told within country. It's less than 10 years old, but the immense staying power this album has made it into a cultural classic among the old country community. It's a love record I'd say even surpasses Red, if I'm being honest. I could rave about how nearly flawless Cover Me Up is. And yeah, I will. Possibly the greatest love song I've ever heard, I'm not joking. The story is both displayed as so heartfelt, tough to swallow, yet also triumphant at the same time. The song represents Isbell's commitment to his wife, his devotion, and chances are you already know how much he displays it. Every detail feels raw and genuine, from the details of Magnolia to the tearing of the dress. Like Isbell is prone to do, he gives us tough pills to swallow, but unlike a certain album, doesn't present them in a narcissistic manner that's outright sexist. Elephant is nothing but a tragedy from beginning to end. Toxicity tearing a relationship apart in such a genuine and realistic manner. I remember the first time listening to it, I just immediately broke down as the weight of what I just heard finally sunk in. The album's subtleties with its dark and mature subject matter just increase a lot of the eeriness the album has. The album challenges ourselves to look inwards in ways very few albums can accomplish. Different Days force me to look back at some of the regrets I've had. Nothing on the level of what's described in the album, but still. Very few albums are able to get people to look at themselves once it's over. I love how this album doesn't even end properly. Are we susceptible to depression and addiction still, or are we capable of moving past it completely? I love how Isbell leaves it up to ourselves with relatively easy, or at least that's how I interpret it. And upon that revelation, I think this is the first time an album has ever broken me. A pre-Mr. Misunderstood album did that. I cherish this record so much, and I can find absolutely nothing wrong with it or something I dislike. Southeastern is an experience I want everyone to listen to and to sink. This is only number 4 on the list. Whenever there's a piece of art that is held as nothing but an untouchable masterpiece by a majority of people, I rarely buy into the hype. Most often I say, yeah, it's great. but a masterpiece? I don't know about that. There are some exceptions to the rule, however, but they're very few and far between. Metamodern Sound is arguably the most critically acclaimed country album in the past 20 years. The amount of sheer expectations people held it to seemed almost impossible to reach, and if it didn't live up to the hype so many people held it to, I wouldn't fault it at all. But that begs the question, does Metamodern Sound live up to the hype? Well, let's take a look. Unlike the first album that opens up pretty energetically, this album opens up with the ethereal Turtles All the Way Down, and almost immediately on my first listen just a few years ago, I knew that this album would become nothing short of a masterpiece. Its cosmic tone takes the styles of the past and presents them in a new lens, making it stand out far more than anything in Cobb's repertoire. Of course, great atmosphere and tone are only one thing without great writing, and thankfully, Metamodern Sounds flies past this. The songs are pretty much all perfect. They're all memorable and unique in their own way. The production, while using classic techniques, offer a richness not present in any Cobb record, let alone Sturgill. The album's theological roots make for something so unique yet grounded. Life of Sin, while seemingly minuscule on the surface, delves into some pretty dark themes while being pretty mid on the emotional spectrum delivery-wise. This song made me reassess my priorities in life, in chasing after what I want to do as a music educator. A message I really needed in a time of my life where I was confused and didn't know what to do. Voices, my favorite Sturgill song, is nothing but pure poetry to my ears, and highlights a lot of internal conflict I rarely see albums tackle in terms of retrospection. The album takes on a variety of themes and links it all back to this grand theme of a higher power, while also maintaining a classic outlaw sound portrayed in all these whacked out concepts for songs. The album does everything I want a sophomore album to do. Progress the themes of an album in a new profound way, expand upon the musical concepts of your previous album, and just simply offer more than your previous record ever did. So when you ask me if Metamodern Sounds in country music lives up to its reputation, my answer would have to be a resounding yes. Similar to my Eric Church ranking, my number 2 pick is the critical best Dave Cobb record, and my number 1 is my absolute favorite. So, without further ado, my number 2 album is The Bird and the Rifle. I have seen very few albums that are capable of reaching this level of perfection. One of the grandest and most well-realized albums of our time. In some ways, I compare this album to the film Lady Bird. The name thing is a coincidence. With its longing to escape and move on and release yourself of others holding you back. Rekyu sees an emotionally confused protagonist try to find an answer for a no longer blossoming relationship, driving themselves to the conclusion that all they do is wreck the other. And in the following track, we highlight this great divide within this case, the bird flying away from the rifle. From there on out, this album takes us on a journey, not necessarily a linear one or even about the same person, but highlights the relationships we as people experience throughout our lives, a sense of brokenness a lot of it can have, sharing both equally the pain and the joys we get from it. We Were Cool reflects on the happiness that could come from problematic people in our lives. Despite all the problems, we could still hold on to those moments that gave us happiness. I wish I found this album sooner because it's enough to really break anyone down. The variety of topics aren't just limited to what I described. It's a story based on women and their struggles to make it in the world and their restriction in society as well. And Lori ties it all together beautifully. It shouldn't be understated that Lori McKenna is the grandmaster of modern songwriting. The way she weaves a story is so clear, so realistic, it's mind-blowing after all this time. Despite me listening to several of her albums, The Bird and the Rifle is nothing short of exceptional. It's possibly the best country album of the decade. And you know what makes this even crazier? Is that we aren't even done with the video yet.
It's time for the moment you've been waiting for!
I really shouldn't beat around the bush, so let's get right to it. Southern Family isn't just my favorite Dave Cobb record, it's also my second favorite album of all time. Better than any Taylor Swift, Sturgill Simpson, or Jason Isbell record. There is only one album that I like more than this. Gee, I wonder what it could be. After years of aiding the visions of other artists, Dave Cobb was finally able to make the masterpiece he was always destined to do. Featuring new and familiar faces you've seen throughout this entire list, this album tore me apart in just the opening track alone. Simple Song serves as such a powerful and tearful eulogy which sets up a lot of the album forward. At points, this album feels like I'm watching a musical with all the distinction of the characters within the concept record. Takes on motherhood, being the head of the family, death, divorce, presenting things most people often go through in a way that's rooted in the beauty that can be found in Southern culture. Values of work ethic, sense of togetherness even in the worst of times, God is a working man, Mama's table, and Grandma's garden have really broadened my viewpoint and my appreciation for the family I have, flaws and all. Some might look down on the traditions this album displays. My favorite works of fiction often deal with family, often with them in a dysfunction, so it's no surprise this album works for me as well as it does. Mama's Table brings this sense of joy surrounding this table nobody dare forsake. Stories like these just hit incredibly hard for me because of how down to earth they are. Family is portrayed as raw and true, and for a northern kid making it through his life, these stories of Essex, brothers, and love, and death in the family do so much for me. I haven't adored an album this much in a long time. And to think, this album had so much writing against it, with it not being only a concept record, but each song handled by different people. That sounds like a disaster waiting to happen given how bad the Hickstape project is. But there are no story issues. There are no weak links. Southern Family is a rare example of everything coming together to form something so impactful with a perfect story and nearly equally powerful tracks. It may not be the magnum opus Metamodern Sounds is, or the best record that is The Bird and the Rifle, but there's something a bit ironic with the only album on this list with Dave Cobb's name on it, with it being my absolute favorite.